So here we are, and I want to just say, I hope I made my point last week when we talked just about the fact that theology is extremely practical. And I've had people come say to me sometimes, you know, theology is kind of dry, and I like something practical, and I just don't know how you can talk about God, a study of God, as being dry. The problem isn't with God, I don't think. So anyway, that was kind of a very personal exposure in terms of each one of those 10 things were things that my daughter and I actually spoke about during her illness and ultimate passing on to be with the Lord. And it was so thrilling to know God had already said something, because he knew the situation, and what he had said applied well. So tonight, I could have done it in a reverse order, because the topic tonight is something we're all going to be going home and changing our life about. I promise you that. If you're not, I feel obligated to, because the Bible says that a teacher is under double judgment, and if they don't practice what they teach, watch out. Now, God's gracious, and I love that in Hebrews 11, when he gives the record of all the by faith people, he never says that Abraham lied twice about his wife, calling her his sister. Never said all the times Jacob arm wrestled with him. Everything is by faith. This is what they did right or did well. So I'm encouraged by that. And so I have done a little thinking about this particular thing, meditation, more so in the last few years, because there's so many oopses related to meditation. It goes way back. In terms of the Bible, it says in the book of Genesis, Isaac, waiting for Eliezer to bring home Rebecca from Haran, because she's the DNA they need for the godly seed, he's out in the field, and it says he's meditating, thinking. And I've wondered, what is he meditating about? Is he trying to imagine? I mean, that's a lot of people say, I have to first of all imagine what Rebecca looks like. No, I don't think he had any idea. He might have had his fingers crossed saying, I'm hoping. She's a beautiful woman. The point is, he basically is probably realizing that it's God who's going to bring that woman. Because if you remember the story of Eliezer, when he goes and he meets the family, the details are amazing on what Rebecca does and how willing she is and the conversation. And we just know that the Lord has brought this woman. So whether he's praising, thanking in advance for the right woman, or just kind of mulling over what it's going to be like after he has a wife. I love the last verse in the chapter. It says this, and Isaac took Rebekah as his wife into his mother's tent. The point is, he takes her in, and here's a beautiful comment. He's comforted after his mother's death. So all of that that picture, it shows me meditation, bringing God into the situation, as mundane or earthy as waiting for your wife, being comforted by her presence because your mother just died, that's what our God is like. And he gives us enough to mull over and think about to give us wisdom related to meditation. So let me take you back about 24 years from now, go back. And I had been skiing in Vail. I have a friend in Texas, in Dallas, Shirley Hull. She's a very longtime friend. Gary and I met her and her husband 2 weeks after we were married in Dallas, Texas, when Gary was a seminary student. And they were Canadians, and he knew my mother, my brother. This is out of the blue. We just show up at this church. And I came from a church where you always read a letter introducing the person, so the elders of the church would know that if I end up taking communion, I have a right to, because I actually know Jesus. And my maiden name, my elders used my maiden name, not my married name. Well, of course, they got up and came over and said, are you Dave Jones's sister? And I said, well, yes. You know, who are you? And we began to be good friends and have over the years. Well, we were skiing, and on our way home, she turned to me and said, in Colorado, she said, Elizabeth, have you got a new doctor? Now, we had moved back to Dallas after 20 years in Canada. So this would be 1989 we moved. This is 1991. And I said, no, I had a hard time getting a new doctor. I had been so used to my doctor of 17 years, I thought, boy, I wonder if he'll move with us. It'd be nice. It's nice to have a doctor you recognize that you don't have to, I mean, they just know what's going on and all of that kind of thing. And so I'd kind of put it off. And then she showed me the Time magazine, 1991. It was a picture of a woman, and it showed her breast and some of the ways cancer could involve a woman's breasts. And she said, Elizabeth, you need to go read this, and you need to go get a doctor. Make sure you always stay checked, that because my mother had died of breast cancer. And I just thought, okay, I will. I always did what she told me to do, because I'm a fourth in the list in family, so I always had five parents anyway. And so, sure, I did. I got a doctor and found myself in an office where the doctor had examined me, and he said, you know, I think you've got a cyst in your right breast, and I'm going to just insert a needle and see if I can get some fluid out of it. You'll go home happy. And he never said any more, and I kind of felt a little nervous, and the truth of it is he ended up finding two places in that breast where he had suspicious growths, a pea-sized growth and a very hard kind of tumor feeling. And as soon as he was saying that, a verse came to my mind, you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. And it just came across my mind, and I thought, because I was in a bit of a sweat, and it was kind of everything stood still. And I thought, what's gonna happen to me? And well, what did happen to me? I had a mammogram, showed two growths, I had a biopsy, showed that it was malignant, and within a week and a half I had a radical mastectomy and all my lymph system taken, or lymph nodes. I know some of you guys are all in the medical field, so I better not use words that I don't understand, and you do know, and I'll just say they took a lot of stuff. And the point is, I was not looking for a verse. At that moment, I was just sitting in, you know, they always have green on the walls in doctor's offices. And I'm always trying to figure out, they need a color, upgrade that color and, you know, change the linoleum. You can tell how old that room was. And God, the Holy Spirit, brought to my mind, you have died. And your life is hidden with Christ in God. And I thought to myself, I wonder where that's from. I mean, I knew it was from somewhere in Colossians, but I didn't know where it was housed. What little paragraph. And that happens a lot. I'm sure it happens to you. God the Spirit, because he's the author of Scripture, brings back things right when you're in the middle of wondering or having a conversation, or you might even be praying. He brings back what you've already placed in your heart. And so later, anyway, I had surgery, and God's been gracious. I just believe God gave me back my life. If he, this surgeon had not done such a good job and the doctors hadn't moved so quickly, who knows what would have happened. And so I'm very thankful. But I was more thankful that the Spirit of God brought that verse, and I thought, when I have a minute, because, see, I said to the surgeon when I had to go, and he was telling me, you know, how long this is going to take and what. So I said to him, this is how I didn't understand the situation. How long is this going to take? I mean, is this a big surgery? And how long is it going to take? Because I'm in the middle of studying Ezekiel at seminary, and I'd like to finish it within the allotted time. And he was a Jewish physician, Dr. Aronoff, and he kind of rolled his eyes and said, ma'am, this is your life. You know, Ezekiel can wait. And so God took care of all the details, and Gary, I was teaching in the Lay Institute at Dallas Seminary, and he took the classes for me. We always kind of switch around, because he does a different kind of thing than I do, as you're now finding out. And so God was kind to give me health, and I found out that it's in chapter 3 of Colossians, and it's part of a paragraph. And of course, as I was learning in seminary, the Bible was never written in verses. It was always written in thought patterns or paragraphs. So that's what I want to talk to you a little bit tonight. Although I do want to admit one thing. Sometimes when you're in a crunch, or you're frightened, or you're in a situation and you don't know what the answer is, I think it's okay that the Spirit of God just brings a phrase to your mind. Because you know, I don't like being on my own, so I'm kind of counting the days when Gary's less than a week now. And thanks for praying for him. I'm going to do a real sidebar. This is my style, so we'll go with it, won't we? Thanks for praying for him. He made it on Malaysian Air all the way to Taipei. Now, that was a challenge, because wasn't it somewhere in the news recently about some problems? But anyway, he said, oh yeah, I was going to kind of read it to you. It was kind of fun to read what he said about Taipei. I looked it up and found out I was familiar with it as being Formosa. After the war, well, around 1600, the Dutch called it Formosa. And after the war, World War II, and Chiang Kai-shek, I believe he was returning or releasing Taiwan, as the Far Easterners are calling it, even though we've continued to think of it as Formosa, that really goes, it's an island called Taiwan. And he said this, just arrived in Chiayi, about 150 miles south of Taipei, so it's down south, flew into it, then an hour-long high-speed 200 miles plus train ride. Taiwan, very Chinese, less evidence of English than Beijing. We'd been in Beijing a couple of years ago. Very white faces, the OBD, if you see, that's not like OCD, it's OBD, okay? Or our daily bread doesn't speak English, but enough do, and they're very kind. Full day tomorrow, 3 2-hour sessions, then train back to Taipei. So he's having a good time, and I know he'll be glad. He's always glad to say hello and always glad to say goodbye, just like the grandkids when they come and go. Anyway, back to the night. I remember thinking, I'm going to go to sleep tonight and I'm going to ask the Lord to be with me. And Psalm 34 kept coming. The angel of the Lord surrounds those who fear him. And that came to my mind all night. So there's times when a phrase or a sentence or a verse is just what you need, because it's the Spirit of God coming alongside and encouraging you. So what I want to do is I want to kind of just give you an introduction to meditation and let you know what biblical meditation is. There are 4 pages. I always have more material than I can use, and I find myself rushing toward the end. So I just want you to know, on the 4th page, it's something you can do on your own if we don't get to it. It's basically the next step. A block diagram, how to take a paragraph, separate it a little bit grammatically, and then try and follow what I've given you just before on some rules on a Bible study, how context is everything, words matter, definitions are important, that kind of thing. And what did the first audience hear when they said, are there any other places in the Bible where a specific word that's in the paragraph can be elaborated on? Because one of the things about memorizing scripture is it's helpful to actually understand what you're memorizing. And so some of those rules, some of you have been in classes where I've taught these on page 4 at the top. What is the second audience? We are the second audience. We are not the first, the primary audience. So it's worthwhile thinking when, and Matthew 11:28-30 will be our little model, what when Jesus said that, where did that come in the book of Matthew in chapter 11? What came before? What came after? What came just ahead in the chapter? That kind of thing. And then what principles are there so that they're lasting lessons and principles that are inherent in statements of truth? And then ask yourself lessons to apply, specs, I call, put on your specs, sin, promise, example, correction, doctrine, something to learn so I'll trust and obey. There it is. This is for you, and if we don't get to it, I've already done it, okay? All right, let's begin then, and I'll stop and ask for questions if you have any, but if my preference is if I'm talking, because I talk fast sometimes just so I can get through, if you have a question right there, then just put your hand up or just do that. I do that in my classes at Talbot Seminary, because sometimes if somebody there, not here, but if someone has a question, we want to discuss it in detail, it ends up taking more time, and I would like to answer the question as quickly as possible. So just remember that if I don't end up stopping. Okay, what I've tried to do is give you some definitions from some well-seasoned writers and people. Some of them are alive, some of them are not. Some of them lived in the 1800s, 1900s, and now our century. Just to give you some idea of what they think, and I trust them, what they think about biblical meditation. So Albert Mohler, he's with the Southern Baptist president, excellent man. If you want a good blog to watch, you can watch The Briefing. That's what he does. I always love, if I'm stuck, somebody asks me a question and I don't know what to say, absolutely, because I'm not as, I haven't done my homework as much, I will go on Mohler's blog. Or I'll go on Tim Challey's, who is a very good critiquer of books that come down the pike, as it were. And it helps me get an idea where I need to look and how I need to think. This is what he says about meditation. The Bible speaks positively about meditation. And then he refers to the Psalms. David talks about it. Meditating day and night. And the biblical concept of meditation. Now, this is going to be at the heart of what true biblical meditation is versus New Age meditation, Buddhistic thinking, yoga, Tai Chi. Oh, I can never say the other one. Oh, it's on the next page. I'll get to it. But a lot of the Eastern thinking is of people in a trance or people in a room with a pad and a pencil, either beginning to automatic writing, because they're emptying their mind, waiting for something to fill it. Now, if you go online and look into that, you're going to discover that it's a psychological thing, most secularists believe. Some will say it's got two sources. One is going to be either a spirit of some sort outside the person, or it's a subconscious way of thinking. And we are able to think subconsciously. Think about your dreams. I mean, it's sometimes, and look, please don't put any stock too much in dreams. The Bible already tells you where you get a dream. It comes from too much busyness. That's what the Proverbs say. A dream comes because you've been far too busy today or this month or this week. And you're usually trying to solve things. And personally, with dreams, I can never get through a door. I try not to have them. Because if I'm going to have a door, I would like to get through it. And that's very dissatisfying to have that kind of a dream. All right, so here's what Mohler says about meditation. It's about thinking. I love what he says. Thinking that is directed by the Word of God. This is for Christians. That's what biblical thinking is. Can I just say this? Remember last week I told you, when it comes to, does the Lord know the future? That was one of the things Janice and I talked about. Does he know the future? Does he know my future? Did he know this? And that's why those verses I gave you, those that answered the question, of course he does. And open theism is a crock. And so you don't go that route to say, well, he knows the past and present, but he's limited himself on the future. And I think that doesn't even make sense. I'm not going to pay a lot of attention to it. But what this is important to tell us is that it's directed by the Word of God. So I'm commanded to meditate. And so those of you who know Jesus, your primary truth, theological truth to hold on to is the Trinity. Remember, that's what we said last week. Anybody who's having trouble with the Trinity, like Arius, who is our primary, worst, most difficult, off-the-chart heretic, is the one who began to diminish the person of Christ. And so we've got all sorts of choices out there now. But the point is true for meditation. I need to understand the equality of the three persons of the Trinity, and I need to understand the roles of the Trinity. The Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world, or as the theme of Matthew is, to be the Christ, the Messiah, the King of Israel. And the Father and the Son send the Spirit, who has written the 66 books that we hold in our hand, and it becomes our primary source for meditation. He's the one who lives within the believer. So at your new birth, the Spirit of God comes in his fullness Not one arm at a time, a leg at a time. You hope you get the head some. Not like that. Not bits and pieces, but fully. And then we spend a life growing up into him. So that's why, if you know Jesus, you have every right to expect the Spirit of God to bring to mind what you've put in your mind from God's word, or maybe even what you've heard preached over the years, or somebody said something, quoted something to you at a table. I've had the most unbelievable places where God's Spirit used somebody to say something to me or write something to me, and I can't even forget it. It's that precious and that much of a treasure. So the Trinity is important in the whole issue of meditation. So here's what he calls it, spiritually saturated thought. So what we're not looking for only, now this may be true for you to have an intentional, deliberate moment. We talk about quiet times. But sometimes you're reading the Bible, and you know, I think we're all in a hurry. I personally do not read the Bible in a year. I cannot, I will, I'm going to be really honest with you, because in case you think I'm some kind of a Christian hero, I'm not. I don't like it because I don't remember when I read it too fast. And if I get stopped, my kids will tell you when I've read the Bible to them in the past, I've been reading it, and then I want to try and explain. This is a really good thing to explain, and they will always say, could you just read what the Bible says? You know, just leave all the extra words out. So I love that definition, spiritually saturated thought. And so then he goes on to say, and he's fighting, or he's defending the fact that we don't empty our mind. New Age says we empty our mind to let in something. What he'll say with that, I think it's just so wise, we must empty our minds of ungodly and unbiblical facts and thoughts. Now, sometimes I get to the end of the day and I think, have I sinned today? You know how you kind of want to cover it before you go to sleep. And I'm ashamed to say, I'm sometimes so insensitive to some of the ways I think or the retorts I give that I don't even see it as a problem. And I have to ask the Lord to show me. You know, and I try and think. Now, I don't spend forever. If it doesn't come relatively quickly, and, you know, I'm not alone in the house, I like to go to sleep quickly. But he does say, the desires for sin and resistance to the reign of God in our life. But that, and here it is, that emptying never involves an empty mind. So a Christ follower is a discerner of thoughts of her mind. Now, we're told the word of God is that. It's a double-edged sword. In Hebrews 4, we're told. It cuts away, it separates the junk from the good stuff. And the word of God, that's why we need a daily dose for it to come into our lives. So the meaning, here's just a quick meaning. I am not a Hebrew scholar, but I listen to one all the time. I've listened to S. Lewis Johnson, and I listen to my husband. And both of them loved Hebrew as much as they loved Greek. And I like it when they can tell me what the English words mean. And you know, often there are many words, because English is very chintzy, I was going to say, but other languages are full and have many words, and we don't seem to have that. So the Hebrew word means, it's H-A-G-A, haga, means to murmur, and by implication, to ponder. And so here are some of the other words, mourn, mutter, speak, study, talk, utter, and at times observe. So it's a very wide tent under this idea of meditation, and we'll find that when we go to the Psalms, which is one of the most amazing books. It's the hymn book where they sing to each other, they call on God, they talk to God, they continually talk about the history. Psalms 104 to 107 are all historical. All on the past of history. If you're bad on history of the Old Testament, read 104, 5, 6, and 7, and you'll have a crash course in the history of Israel from the Old Testament. In the New Testament, the word consider or observe and think offers the same instruction to take time to deliberately reflect on God. And we'll look at these a little bit later, but the consider word, it's kind of like, and I've given you it's a time-release coal capsule. So if I take some stuff you take to dry up your nose, it just works right away. In Greek, verbs are like that. They're either immediate or they have a time-released ability to move. So for instance, the word consider in James 1, consider it all joy, is really sit still, stop wiggling, and just consider this joy, this trial, Because the goal the Lord wants for you is to know that this that it, someone else may have made it meant it for evil, but He is going to mean it for good in your life. So it takes time, by the way. That's a process to consider. Some of you've got stuff in your home life. Some of you've come up through churches that have lied to you, and you think, you know, am I ever going to feel unbetrayed? And it takes time. And I think unless you actually work through it to the point where you not accept it as having happened necessarily, but understand this is not the end of my life. It's a new beginning. Once you get to that point, there becomes a point, and I haven't been exactly where some of you have been, but I have been in times where I've had an embittered spirit, and I don't want it because I'm warned from Scripture. It's like a big tree that, you know, just destroys everything. And when I intentionally process, call on the name of the Lord, give it over to Him, and ask Him, take it out of my mind, it is possible eventually, and I hope more quickly than slowly, to be able to let it go so that you don't even recall it when you used to the way you used to recall it. I think that's the goal with any kind of learning or meditation, in depending on your topic. So let me give you an example, and that's the cow down below. I had a hard time shrinking that guy. He's big on the web. But I don't know much about these words even, but I do know the word chew the cud. We had my doctor in Calgary was missionary in Angola for many years, Dr. Arthur Stinton, and on the side, he bred very, very special cows. Now, Alberta's the place to do beef. Some of the best beef you'll eat is in Alberta. And so this is an interesting thing, and I don't want to read that whole thing, but I try and highlight some of the words so you can look at them right away and we can move. So here's the question I asked. What is cud and why do cattle chew it? Okay, in case you think it's a bubble gum or something like that. And you notice, have you ever noticed they're always chewing it? Sheep are that way. It has to do with their mouth, the lack of teeth that they have, and they have to chew it in order for it to digest. Otherwise, it'll be poorly digested. And so here's some facts. 8 hours every day chewing their cud. Well, at least they've got something to do, right? This plus normal chewing can total up to 40,000 jaw movements per day. And they're ruminant animals. That means their stomach has four compartments. So there they are. And I'm so sorry the letters are small, but you can go online and if you want to make a poster of this, go ahead and do it on your own time. All right. We don't need to know the physiology of this, but I do want to just make some comments. A cow takes a first bite, chews enough to moisten the food. So that first encounter is kind of minimal, all right? And then once it's swallowed, it follows through and goes through. The softened food is called cud. Then the muscles send the cud back. This is not a pretty picture when it comes to cud, but it's a wonderful picture when it comes to the bread or the milk of the word. Or as the writer of Hebrews will say, you guys, you should be done with milk. You need meat. Have a good Albertan steak. Okay? So it goes. So just go down to the dark lettering. Cud chewing is often used as an indicator of a healthy and comfortable herd. A happy, healthy animal will produce more milk or have a higher production of muscle. Animals who do not chew the cud properly may be scared or have digestive issues such as twisted stomachs, displaced, their fourth section of the stomach. Now, the point is this. They're not fight animals because they can't get ahead. You know, a little lamb is the same way. Sheep is totally defenseless. No way of biting you because there's nothing up there to get you with. And so if you turn them over, they stay there. They don't know, they can't help themselves. They need a shepherd to help them. These animals are similar. The cattle, they run when they're afraid. And because of the arrangement God has made in their bodies, if they're in the middle of eating, in the situation they run to, they have the time now then to bring back the food that they needed to chew, and it will ultimately be digested and meet the needs and make their body strong. Now, I think it's a beautiful picture. The only reason it's a picture, it's never used as a metaphor in the Bible. I mean, the elegant ones are the tree water by the rivers of water, that sort of thing. But that's what we do when we partake of God's word. And I hope you'll understand that you've read lots in the Bible and haven't remembered it, right? And sometimes you're going to just have to sit down and do the Awana thing. Are any of you familiar with Awana? It's a wonderful organization that basically teaches children how to memorize scripture. Now, I think they do it in verses, but you know what? I think verses are better than nothing. And some of us don't even do verses, right? So I'm just hoping this will be an encouragement to you. Cud chewing is necessary, all right? Because you need a good system to digest the ongoing taking in of scripture. And so that's kind of the big picture. There we are. Let's go to page 2. And I want to just talk a little. Here's some great quotes. I could spend my whole day just finding yummy quotes because it sounds so eloquent when others use it. And here's some more from James Packer, his book, Knowing God. Those of you who haven't read it, I would like to encourage you to read it. And he's a very nice man. I one time signed up for a class in Calgary when we were in Calgary because I've always been a frustrated student, always looking for places I could sign up and go. And I took this class of the Doctrine of God, and you know, he was kind of, he's very, very elegant and astute and erudite, 3 E's. And he lectures very in control with a beautiful English accent. And so when you read the book, you read it more with your own mind. And but here they are. Meditation is an activity of calling to mind, thinking over. There it is. Aren't these helpful? I think they're helpful. It's dwelling on, applying to one, everything. What one knows about works, ways, purposes, and promises. Number 2, it's an activity of holy thought. Consciously. Now, sometimes, I think when you begin to meditate because you've memorized, because you're learning the words in it, that certainly is intentional. Praise God, the unintentional recalling of is God's Spirit's work to do. And if it's there, he can bring it back. It's like Morgie's studying for exams tonight. She needs to get them in her head because tomorrow when she writes 2 of them, she couldn't say, well, I'm going to ask the Lord to bring back to mind chapter 15 in my chemistry book, because if she hasn't put it in, it's not going to come. It's the same thing. The things we know we've placed in of the word come back to our mind because God the Spirit has burned them on our hearts. Its purpose is to let his truth make its proper and full impact. And I like number 4. It's a matter of talking to oneself about God and oneself, not in that self-focused way, but arguing with myself. I don't always like what I read in the scripture. I like most of it. Some of it I really love. There are times when I read it and I think, poof, I don't think I could ever do that. And I can't in my own strength, and neither can you. And that's why we have to have these long conversations. Or if you're just one of those people that are quickly obedient, great. I praise you. Number 5, the effect is ever to humble us. As we contemplate God's greatness and glory, basically, the last sentence, the most important one, as we contemplate the unsearchable riches of divine mercy displayed, and I am so sorry that L didn't get capitalized, in the Lord Jesus Christ. All I know is this. When Jesus walked the 2 miles from Jerusalem to Emmaus with the very dejected travelers, when he began to break the bread. Now, I'm not saying the bread in the house yet. That's when they recognized him and he left. Phew, he's gone. But when he's breaking the scripture bread, he told every time, this is about me. This is about me, Moses and the prophets. So when we open scripture, we're not going to find moral, we're not looking for moral ethics. They're there, but that's not our focus. Or how do we create a system of theology? I love systematic theology, but that's not the purpose of the Bible. It's for us to find the Savior. And that's really what memorization helps us do, so we can meditate. Well, there's George Mueller. Here's his big deal. Meditation was not so much how I might serve. I have people ask me that all the time. I'm just wrestling about what I can do. Listen, some of these things, it's all in Scripture. You can learn from there. The Lord wants you to serve him. He wants more, that your soul be happy. That's what Mueller said. And if you don't have not ever, how many have read a biography or autobiography about George Mueller? Any of you? Okay, one. Okay, guys, you've got an assignment you need to do. Over the summer, you need to try and find some biographies. The Redlands Library has quite a few of these. This one's an autobiography. And he said the main thing I had to do, he's the man who brought in all these little orphans and gave homes to them, sometimes didn't have them food for the day, and called on the name of the Lord, and a horse and a little wagon's outside, and it's full of bread for the children for the day. Amazing stories, wonderful. Now, sometimes he had to wait a little bit on that too, but I encourage you. He had to give himself, he says, to the reading of the word, to meditate, so my heart might be comforted, encouraged, warned, reproved, instructed. Okay? Oh, there's so many things we could say here. Any questions or comments at this point? You guys are all still awake? Okay. All right. Let's see what time it is. We're good. All right. Alexander White, Scottish pastor. In the 19th century, he basically said, the mind is the highest thing. Why do you suppose he'd say that? Related to Christian truth and believers, true believers in Christ. Well, how about this verse? Faith comes by, and hearing by, and the word of God is taken into my mind. I have to be able to take it into our mind. It's a truth. We're really, our faith is a truth-based faith. So when he says, the mind is the highest thing, the meditation is the highest use of the mind. So you can read the rest. So why do we have so little faith? Why are our minds so blighted and barren in the things of God? We have so little hold of the reality and nobility of the divine things because we never meditate. And so I think, I know I'm not going to go out tonight and go home and sit down for 4 hours and meditate, but what I want to learn, and this is what I would want this to be your take home, that you understand you can meditate any time, day or night. And if you have the Word of God in your heart, and you can recall it. Now, Gary has wakened me up sometimes. He loves Romans 8. And I mean, come on, the middle of the night. Yes, it's how it comforts him, and it wakes me up, but I'm not going to complain because it's the rich word of God, and it comes to your mind, and that's what it does. It's the highest use of the mind, and we need to keep on doing it. We need to keep on getting it in so we can bring it up. All right, Paul Meyer, this is a current writer, got up close, how to meditate on his word. He's quoting Paul Meyer. He's being quoted by Doug McIntosh here, that helping people attain spiritual well-being is scripture meditation. That's the most valuable thing, he will say. And then here from his book, he gives a great little, it's not a technique. I don't like techniques. I don't believe there's any techniques that we're given that we need to follow in Scripture. What we do need to do is follow what the commands say. That's what they are. We are. And we need. And he says we realize the truth, we reflect on the truth, and then we respond to God in thanksgiving to that truth. And now here's the rest of the Albert Mohler meditation comment. The topic of this piece that he's writing is called The Empty Promise of Meditation. And this is where I'm not going to go into all the details of how barren false meditation is, and it's slipped into Christian circles. And unless you understand and are discerning, you might just kind of blow it off. So at the top of the one of the other pages, S. Lewis Johnson says that. Three, there it is. Error is best seen in the light of truth. So I'm trying to follow that just by giving you this one piece from Albert Mohler. This biblical meditation is the opposite of Eastern meditation, which sees the emptying of the mind as the goal. The Eastern concept of emptying the mind is just not anything close to biblical vision of filling the mind with the Word of God. Some approach meditation through Buddhism, others through Eastern religion. More and more Christians meditate through the ancient ritual of centering prayer, labyrinth, that kind of thing that sends you aside, and they're somehow in a very mystical, superstitious even way, somehow you're going around and around coming. I had an experience once where from an organization, we were all asked to put our little earphones on and carry our little black recorder. And we were listening to this woman's voice, slow and soft and kind of mesmerizing, and somehow get to the end so that we were, this is a Christian thing, this is not me out wandering in the daisies. And the bottom line is, we came back and the head of the group, which was one my boss, said, well, now how did you feel about, like, what, how did you enjoy that? Everyone, 20 people, this was just, and I could hardly believe, I didn't put my hand up, and he said, Elizabeth, I didn't hear from you, that's right. I said, I just think this is something that we don't get in Scripture. Why are we doing it? I couldn't understand anything she meant. There were no Scripture, it was just all talk. And it just feels like it's dulling my senses, not sharpening my mind. So that's really common right now, so be aware of that. While others develop their own style, patterned after the breathing techniques or popular guru Deepak Chopra, most sit still, focusing on a mantra. That's a big deal. I have sometimes Christian people tell me, my mantra for this year is what? Anyway, if you want to get anything for the year, get a Bible verse. I have one for my life, and I sometimes am reading, and I think, you know, I'd love God to be able to do that in my life this week or this year. But that's not, we got the whole Scripture every year, every day, and I would go with that. A movement-based activity such as Tai Chi, automated writing, all the rest of it. All right, so that's where we are. All right, let's turn to page 3. And I just want to fill in some blanks for you. Any questions so far? Okay, now if I didn't mention your favorite pagan meditation form, I apologize, but I think Johnson's right. Error is best seen when we know the truth. It's like the guys that feel they're dealing with counterfeit bills. They never spend their time feeling counterfeit bills. They feel the real thing so that when they feel a counterfeit bill, they should go through a huge dramatic shock because they know it immediately. I'm interested now with certain bills, how they hold them up. They hold them up to the light or they do a stroke on it. And I saw somebody do it with the lady in front of me. So I knew it was a $100 bill. And they know right away it's not counterfeit. All right, here's some things. Specific reminders. Number one, here's to fill in the blanks. Biblical meditation is daily. Now, that comes out of Deuteronomy 6. What are you going to do when you talk to your children? You're going to talk to them. And by the way, meditation isn't just what you say when you're alone or that you're keeping it all in and you're whispering it to God or whatever. It's not the spooky stuff. It's speaking to one another. Remember the Spirit? The New Testament tells us that's a sign that we're filled with the Spirit. We speak to one another and sims and we encourage each other with songs and hymns and spiritual songs, and we make melody in our heart to the Lord, vertical and horizontal. So, and it's purposeful. So Deuteronomy 6 says, if you're a parent, you're doing this with your kids. Well, you do it, and we'll find out when. It's quite common. And then Psalm 1, verse 2, it's daily, night and day, or day and night. I figured out that can happen. Even if you're really a good you're a good person at work and you're concentrating on what your boss, you should concentrate on what your boss has asked you to do. You shouldn't say, excuse me, I failed to get, I always think of that Lucy, I Love Lucy one where she's trying to get the candies in the chocolate. And you remember it, you guys, some of you are nodding your heads. And it's pretty funny because she's just so busy thinking other things. She's not. That's not what meditation can come and go as you're attending to what you should be attending to. And if you should be attending to something, attend to it. You can't use an excuse to say, I was trying to memorize Romans 8 and I was just getting to verse 32, that your boss isn't going to be interested in it. But there are times where you have a moment of freedom and the Spirit of God can bring. So it is possible to pray without ceasing. That doesn't mean you're praying nonstop 24 hours. When are you going to sleep? There's an organization who has made it into that. Instead of just saying, you know what, When I am aware, then I pray. When I am in need, then I meditate. I can think about that verse or that paragraph. All right, number two, biblical meditation is an immediate command. This is Joshua's command. If you remember, he's taking over from Moses, and the Lord says to him, I want you to be strong. And then he says, this book of the law, don't be threatened by the word law. It's just all the seven. You remember testimonies, commands? Psalm 19 uses a bunch of synonyms. It's just the truth of God. And there's different stages over a period of time that God used to bring his people along to the next step for them. And for Joshua, it's not to depart from his mouth, but he is to meditate on it day and night, so you may be careful to do what's written in it. Then you'll make your way prosperous. Then you'll have success. So I wouldn't let it come out of my mouth don't let it come out of your mouth if you haven't ever read the passage. I've sometimes been in Bible studies where the people didn't get their questions answered, and all of a sudden we have this big conversation of what I think it means to me, or well, did you read it? Well, no, I didn't have time. I was okay, then hold it. I think we should just say the ones that did read it get to say the words, right? Something like that. All I know is there's an immediate command. Keep speaking, knowing my law, Joshua, and I'm going to bless you. Number three, biblical meditation has its source and focus as God's truth, God's word. That's the source. That's its basic focus. I want to tell you, for years and years, when I said no to opportunities to do what I'm doing tonight, I did, because I always said no for seven times, because that's the perfect number. And then on the eighth, I would say yes. I've learned not to do it that way, because that's a little bit unnecessary. But what I have learned is that I'm so glad I don't have to talk about anything I have to make up. Do you know the freedom of being able to take the word and someone asks you a question and say, here's what it says. And they don't like what it says. I didn't say it. I'm not the one you have to argue with. It's God, the God of the universe, that said that. And someday, you're going to give an account to him. Sometimes I think, oh, I don't want to say that to that person because I'll lose their friendship. And then I think, that is so silly. They're just man. What is man? And the Lord is the one I need to worry about. And so when it comes to talking, speaking the truth, meditating, I am so glad that the words are not our own words. Listen, if you're a prophet and nothing comes true, you're not a prophet. We talked about that last week, remember? If you have one blow, you're a false prophet. All right, so don't go pushing what you don't know. Number four, biblical meditation focuses on all God's works and his deeds. And the word in here in Psalm 70, you muse about them. You think about them. Listen, nobody can read the Bible really fast and do justice to meditation if you're in a rush, especially all that stuff that Job's friends say to him. I mean, the Lord finally puts his hand over their mouth and say, you did not represent me well, but my servant Job did. All right, number five, and this is wonderful. Biblical meditation is pleasing to the Lord. It's pleasing to the Lord, and we say we want to please the Lord. I even ask the Lord in prayers, Lord, today I want to please you. Well then, have you carved, he doesn't talk to me like this, but I say to myself, have you soul, like David says, soul, why are you downcast? So I say soul, because that's what David called himself. Soul, when are you planning to do that today? If you want to please the Lord and you know what makes him happy, when are you planning to do it? Don't go asking me if you're not willing to go and say, well, I'm going to take some time for this and this and this. So anyway, that's what it is. It focuses on, it's ultimately pleasing to the Lord. He's delighted. It delights his heart. Number six, biblical meditation should focus on who God is. This is what 145 teaches us. These are all passages you can look up later. His mighty works or acts. Let's put acts in there, and his wonderful works. What I'd suggest is if you want to get a practice on some of this, some of the writers in the Psalms will comfort you. And sometimes there are laments too, but I think sometimes meditation sounds as I'm having a conversation with the Lord has a little bit of a lament in it. And then when you get to the New Testament, you see hear these beautiful doxologies that Peter makes, and often at the end, the writer of Hebrews has a beautiful benediction. Paul has loads of prayers. Get familiar with what he's praising God for. So if you can't think and say, I can't think of anything to praise God or to talk to him, to meditate on and think about, then that will help you. All right, this next part is just going to be a really quickly. Or would you like to do it on your own? Let's have a vote on this side. Do you want to do this on your own, this next part? Go home and do it as a little study, or do you want just single words before you go? You want homework. Okay. You want homework. All right. All right, you guys, go home and do it. If you're here with your husband and wife, do it together. See what you come up with. Let me do the first one so you see what I'm writing. We're not doing, this is not a dissertation we're writing. Psalm 49:3. Basically, I'm told that meditation is the way to wisdom and understanding. It gives me that. Psalm 104:34 talks about, we've already actually looked at it, I think, it talks about pleasing the Lord in why we should do it. And then Psalm 119:11 is, I hide your word in my heart, finish the verse, so that I won't sin against you. What a great way to deal with sin. We talk about people repenting and reconciling, but we never talk about sin so that we won't sin again kind of thing. It's just a wonderful, the word of God is wise, and the Psalms will help you with that. All right, I think that you've got everything. There's only one passage I left out, and it's Psalm 19. So in the white space, can you go ahead and write this? This is why, right beside why you should meditate. The law of the Lord is perfect. Here's what it does. It refreshes the soul. It makes you wise. It rejoices your heart. It enlightens your eyes. It lasts forever. The fear of the Lord in terms of the awesomeness of the Lord, it's eternal. His judgment, it's as a judgment, it's true, so I'm well warned. It's more desirable than gold and more sweeter than honey. And it's a fair warning for us. I cannot find a better statement of investment. I don't know if you've got any friends who are financial advisors. David Maupin has helped us over the years, and I one time asked him, hey, can you match Psalm 19:7-11? The point is, nothing can match God's word. Investment in knowing what God has said and following it. All right? Okay, you do 2, 3, and 4 at home and enjoy it. All right, let's go to the memorizing. We got 15 minutes. Is that true? Okay? I think we can do it. You don't have this in your notes, so I just want you to look up here. Yeah, this one's not too good. Was that? Well, that was a yawn, was it? Okay. All right. Memorizing scripture. It's your resource for meditation. Here's what I want you to do when you decide what you're going to want to memorize. So go to page 4. Keep your page 3 on and go to page 4. And I've been doing this month. Matthew 11:28-30. I really had never memorized it so that I can recall it and I know what the words mean. So I'm going to suggest, I've given you, can you see the 10? Actually, I said it was going to be 10. I added one because I really like that last one, for number 11. Okay, but the point is, you guys, you got hundreds of 3, 4 paragraphs. You're looking for paragraphs, pithy statements that will help you in some situation. And so what I want you to know is that some of the rules for understanding the words are kind of up here. And the number one, and this is on page 3, context is everything. And what we mean by that is, I need to know whether I'm memorizing the Old Testament or the New Testament. Because God progressively has revealed himself. We call it salvation, redemption, history. And so there's a time where the Spirit had not yet come. Pentecost was the first time the Holy Spirit descended, sent by the Father and the Son, to indwell individual believers and create a church, birth a church. So when somebody comes to Christ, now, the Spirit of God does the same thing he's always done right from Pentecost on. He's taken a person and placed them in the body of Christ safely, forever. That's called the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And he is indwelled. If you want to know, just read some of Paul's letters, especially the prison epistles, about what the Spirit has done within us. And so if I'm in the Old Testament and I'm memorizing something from David's life and he says, "Do not take your Spirit from me." I'm not sure if that's Psalm 32 or 51. And if it's not either, forgive me, okay? Old Testament, the Spirit of God came and went. And so he anointed people, his children, for a task sometimes. Can I just tell you, you're already, if you're a Christian, you've been anointed. The Spirit of God has come. And you can serve him, serve the Lord in his power. He will be faithful as you obey him. So context is everything. This is the silence, 400 years of silence. This is a picture of the Bible. You can see this. The New Testament, I need to know what book so that I know what's the issue. So, for instance, I need to know whether, is this Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John? Because they all have a different purpose statement. Matthew's concerned about the king. Mark's concerned about the servant. Luke's concerned about the humanity of Jesus, and John's concerned about the deity of Jesus. And that, listen, you are going to love the Bible if you haven't really jumped into it. But one of the things I love finding out is every verse in every book can be traced to the purpose statement. It's that amazing. Because you see, it's a spirit book, even though it was men that were writing it. And it's one of those concurrent things that God can do two things at once that seem like they couldn't go together, but they can when it comes to Scripture. The genre, I need to know what the genre is. Is this Numbers when we're numbering the people? Or is this Galatians when we're dealing with people who are going back to the law? So it's very important for anything I memorize, I need to know which testament and which book and the purpose theme. Now, I would love to recommend, you have to get them online secondhand, but they're worth getting. Wilkinson's books on thinking through the Old Testament, thinking through the New Testament. He did walk through the Bible. Any of you who took walk through the Old Testament, walk through the New at Trinity, know that it was just a wonderful big picture way of getting through. And this is a written kind of, he helps you with purpose statements and helps you with genre and that sort of thing. I get as much help as I can because I can't remember everything. And then the theme. Now, I need to know what chapter in the book that it comes from. Matthew 11:28 is at the end of a very hard day with the Pharisees, the hypocrites who are badgering. In fact, there's a point in the chapter either before or in 11 where the Pharisees come together and they say, "We got to get rid of this guy. We got to get rid of him. He's blaspheming God. We can't afford for him to be let loose among the people." And then, of course, out of his heart, he says, "Come unto me, all you who labor and heavy laden." He calls, what gracious words. So you want to know where, then you know in the paragraph, you want to know what became before and after. Don't take a long time, but actually become familiar with it so you could think, wow, that's in, because see, even in the way the Bible's paragraphs are positioned, they're positioned to such a way that it would be a contrast for him to speak these kind words, having been badgered. And even the plan to put him to death starting to go into effect. And then some key words. Now, that's the important thing. Now, what I've done for you is I've, if you'll go to page 4, I have blocking them. You is understood. Come is an imperative. Remember, we had Gary taught us that there are two kinds of things and statements in the Bible generally. There are many other things, but in a general sense, there are indicatives, statements of truth, and then there are imperatives, response to that truth. And this is what he's saying is, come, you come to me. And so all you who are weary and heavy laden, that's who he's asking. He's asking the people who've been bowed down with the law. The teachers of the law have kind of whipped the people because they've made them follow such a law in such a way that they're burdened all the time. And he's sitting there saying, come to me. It's wonderful, no matter what your background is, and all through your Christian life, to come to realize every day that I wake up, I come to a Savior. I don't come to a technique. I've got to get up and do my blah, blah, or I've got to pray this way, I've got to, whatever. I mean, really, that may come as you pray. You may end up with an easy way of doing it, but you're coming to the same God-man every day. I love that. We're not coming to a person because they fail you. You're not coming to an organization. You're not coming to an institute. You've come to a person. Come to me, all right? So I just made dark some of the ones. My yoke, I've showed you anytime there's repetition, pay attention. When there's repetition, you know that's the most important thing. So rest is in here. And my yoke, it's easy and light. There's something he's offering that's way better than what man can offer you. So once you finish understanding your little paragraph, now you're going to find it a little easier to memorize it. And I think 28 to 30 is a piece of cake. Some of the other ones, like the one we learned in the Christian history class, Titus 2, I found, I had to keep going over that and over that. So here's your 11 to do. And what I try and do with it is, once I've read it, I kind of think, okay, I know where it's from, New Testament. I know which author. He's a Levite. It's going to be really Jewish. All sorts of reminders of quoting the Old Testament throughout Matthew and the presentation of the king. And he's so humble in the way he's presenting himself here, because by the time he gets to chapters 15 and 16, he's going to take the disciples outside of Israel. Caesarea Philippi, those of you who have been to Israel with us, you know, remember standing where the Pan God was, all pagan. And he says, who do people say that I am? You know, some think you're Elijah, some think you're somebody else. But who do you say? And Peter makes those marvelous words. You are the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Isn't that amazing? And what you learn is some of those words ought to give a chill in your body. They're so amazing. King of kings and Lord of lords. Someday he's going to rule. I can hardly wait. Sometimes I think, I wish I could get through the 1,000 years fast so I can get to the new heavens and the new earth. And you know what? He's not in a hurry, so I can relax. And so can you. But fondling the words and understanding them. So you just go through this, and then you're ready to write a one-liner. And I don't know, none of these are inspired, but they're helpful to me. So the Lord, my one-liner was up at the top. Christ, Israel's Messiah and King, is our place for rest. We cease from our works and we come to him for soul rest. That's what he calls it. It's soul rest. Okay? And there's the 11, the rest of them. And final thing, remember, Scripture's inspired, it's God-breathed. It's profitable for all your needs. There's not a single need you have that cannot be met by the triune living God, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. You cannot out-trouble the God of the universe. So we can be adequate. There's a purpose for every good work. So how many of you, I'm not going to ask you to put your hands up. I don't like manipulation myself. Okay, Kathleen put her hand up already. How many of you are going to begin anew and think, okay, pick one of them or make your own list after you filled in the blanks to become convinced. This little list that you're going to fill in should convince you that this is something I need to get better at. But could I just say this? It's the kind of thing I say to often to young women who are mothers, or they're busy and they want to just spend some time with the Lord. I say start with 5 minutes. If you say start with an hour, they're not going to do it. And I mean, I wouldn't be able to do it at a certain time. So start with 5 minutes. And I hope that the thirst of learning even something simple, which will help you understand the Bible, and this is S. Lewis Johnson's favorite quote, when you begin to learn Scripture, you find out you know more Scripture. Now, that does make sense. The truth is, when you learn this verse, you're going to want to go looking for rest. Where in the world, where other place in the Bible is rest? There's a wonderful description of rest in the book of Hebrews. And it's what they didn't let their land do. That's why they went into exile, because they didn't let, every 7 years, they didn't let the land rest. They worked that land because they wanted more money, more food. So, I mean, you've got lots of places to go to cross-reference. And if you don't want to do any of it, just learn the verse. Okay? Any questions or comments? Any excuses? Anybody want to say anything? All right, well, I'm looking for somebody to pray, because, you know, I prefer not to pray in public. So who would like to pray? Would any of you guys like to pray? Christian, would you? Thank you. Just close us. Appreciate that.
God, we thank you for the words of truth. Thank you for Elizabeth's words. Thank you for meditation. It's a beautiful thing. Allow us to become better at meditating and to do it correctly with our minds, our hearts focused on you. Enable us as we go out to better meditate on your word. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Okay, have a good night. And like one of the people we used to listen on to the radio, he'd say, walk with the King today and be a blessing. I can't remember his name, but he's in heaven now.